In this video, we're going to be reading color palettes from a JSON file, and then using one of the color palettes to generate a simple scene. Hey, I'm Victor Stepanoff. I'll be guiding you through this Blender Python tutorial. Today, we're going to be reading color palettes from a JSON file and using that in Blender. So we're going to get a JSON file that's full of color palettes. We're going to translate those color palettes into something that Blender and Python can understand. And then we're going to use that to generate a simple scene. Today, we're going to be using a wonderful resource called colorlovers.com. This resource has a ton of color palettes. We're going to be using the most popular color palettes on this site. This site has a special API that you can use to download palettes using a Python script. I have created such a script that downloads the most popular color palettes on the site. We won't be going over this particular script today. I'll create a separate video on that, so make sure to subscribe to not miss it. But today we're going to be using a pre-made JSON file that I've already generated for you. So we're going to get that and then use it in our scene. So we're going to read in the JSON file through Python, then turn it into something that Python understands, and then we're going to turn in those colors into something that Blender understands. And at the end, we're going to get a scene like this. All right, first things first, let's download the JSON file with the color palettes. In the description, I've provided a link under color palettes link. So open that in your favorite browser and then hit raw right here. Then save this page as, and I would recommend you use the temp folder in C if you're on Windows, or create a temp folder in your home folder on Mac or Linux. So just do that. All right, now we need to get some helper code to start quickly iterating on our script. I've provided a link in the description under start code. So go ahead and navigate to that link in your favorite browser. Hit raw, select the code and copy it. Now let's go back into Blender and let's open the scripting workspace and then hit new right here and then paste in the code that you just copied. All right, as soon as that's done, we are ready to run the script. So I'm going to run it right here with this play button, and the script just clears the scene and adds a camera and an empty. Today, we're not really going to be using the camera or that empty, but it's okay. We're just going to be using it as a clear scene setup. All right, the first thing that we want to do is load the color palettes that we just downloaded. So we need to load that JSON file that's on disk. And to do that, I'm going to define a new function right above here and call it load color palettes. I fast-forwarded the typing that I did here, but I highly recommend that you do the typing on your own, like so that muscle memory starts working, how to use Python and particular Python functions. So let's go over step-by-step what we're doing here. So on the very first line, we're calling this ABS path. So ABS is absolute path, aka full path. We're trying to retrieve the full path to this. And I'm running Windows, and this is going to be C temp and then the file name. On Mac or Linux, we're going to be using the home folder. Remember that you should have saved this file that we're working with into the temp folder in your home folder. So make sure to do that. Something to note is that we're using the OS module. So OS stands for operating system and allows Python to access and work with the operating system that we're running. And in particular, it allows us to work with different file paths, right? Working with a file system and also get information like the operating system we're running. And for Windows, the OS name will return NT. And here I'm checking that it's not Windows. So anything that is not Windows, which is Mac or Linux, we're going to do this. And we're basically expanding the user, the user that we're currently logged in as, right? It's going to give us the full path. And then we're just adding that to the beginning of the path. So we have a nice path here. I would still recommend, if you're only using Windows, to start getting used to this, since Blender is executed on Mac, Linux, and Windows, and you might want to have your scripts be able to run on all operating systems. Next, we are reading the contents of that JSON file. And first things first is we open that file. We're using the path that we just created, right? So we got the object that's referencing our color palette's JSON. Now we need to read the contents. So we're reading the human readable text and getting the JSON text. At this point, Python doesn't really understand this, right? It's a bunch of characters for it. So we need to translate it to something that Python understands. And that's what we are doing here. We're using the JSON module that helps Python understand and read JSON. And we're using the load S. S stands for string, so text in other words. And we're passing in the text of the file that we just read. And we're getting a dictionary of all the color palettes that we just read. And finally, we are closing the file. So we want to clean up after ourselves. So after opening, we should always remember to close the file. And finally, we return the dictionary of the color palettes that we've just read. This code also could be written in a shorter form. So it will look like this. If you're just starting out with reading files in Python, I would highly recommend to stick to this simple and easy format. You could try to pause the video and map what exactly is what in this shorter form. It will do exactly the same thing as you see on the screen right now, but it's just a shorter and more concise form. Now let's store the result of this function. And also, I said this is a dictionary. It's actually a list of dictionaries. So that's an important thing to note. And we're going to store this list right here in the context. So we're going to just create a new entry in this dictionary context. Now we'll be able to access the list of color palettes through this context variable right here. And we're passing it into this function that we're going to be working on our scene in. Now let's print out a random color palette. So we're going to select a color palette and print out all the colors in that color palette. I'm going to go up here and I'm going to define a new function that's going to select a random color. So I've called the function select random color palette, and we're passing in that context. Remember that we just added the color palettes list to. And then we're using the random module and selecting, so choice is at random, it selects from a list one of the values, and we're just passing in our color palettes and then just selecting one of them. You might ask, why are we creating a function for just a single call? You can say, oh, I can just use this in the place where I want it to. I would argue that this is more readable. We are using something that you can read. So like select random color palette is a lot better than random choice and then something inside, right? So let's use that right here in the create centerpiece function. I'll assign a variable to that. And then let's print out all the colors in that color palette. So we're looping over the color palette that we just selected, getting that color, and then printing it out. Pretty straightforward. I'm going to run this script and I'm going to open the system console. On Windows, you will find it under Window and then toggle system console. So this is what I got. This is the system console on Windows. On Mac and Linux, unfortunately, you'll need to do some extra work to get this console going. I have a separate video for both of those operating systems for you, so make sure to check those out. I'll provide a link in the description. And you'll see this, and if we run the script multiple times, we're going to get different hex color codes. In our target scene, we have the 3D text that represents the hex color codes. Let's do that right now. I'll add a new function above the create centerpiece right here and call it create text object. Okay, let's unwrap what I've typed in here. This is basically adding a text, so this is the same thing as you would hover over the 3D viewport and then hit Shift A and then add text, and then you have some text in the scene, right? So that is basically a call to that. Next, we just are getting the currently active object, which is the text object. This is a helper function defined above. You can find it in the helper code section. Next, we're just scaling down the text object, and we're updating the value of the body. So that's the main text body. The same thing as doing this. So, you know, if you're selected the text object, you hit tab, and then you can just add some more text, right? So that's basically what this body does. So you can set whatever text you want here. Next, we are setting the origin to the center of the object. Notice that the origin is right here, and we want it to be in the middle, right? So if I set origin and then center of mass, you can see that the origin jumped right here. And next, we're just setting the location. If you check out the panel, the properties panel of our current select object, this has moved. As soon as we moved the origin, this was updated. So I'm gonna just set that to zero, and you can see the text object jumps into the middle of the scene. So this is exactly what we're doing here. Next, we are doing the extrude, the fill mode, and the bevel depth. So let's go into the text properties. So for fill mode, we are selecting none right here. And remember, all of these, all of the commands that I'm doing, you could see right here in the info panel down below, right? So I was adding the text object here, right? That was setting the origin, right? And then we are also setting the fill. So that's how I'm getting all this information right here. Next, we need to extrude. So let's set that to 007. You can see that there's some extrusion going on. That's great. Now let's set the bevel depth. We're going to go down here. Now it's nice and thick. And finally, we just return this object that we created. And let's use this function down below. So instead of printing, we're going to just pass that in, and we're just going to create a variable. Move this a bit like so. Okay, now let's run our script. And you can see that all these color codes are just overlapping on each other. It's not great. Let's move them around. Let's define a special variable. We're going to be updating this current Y on each iteration of the for loop. Okay, so we created a new variable right here, and then we are accessing the location property and exactly the Y coordinate, and then just using the current Y location, applying that, and then updating at the very end of this for loop body. Let's run the script. All right, look at that. So we're already getting something interesting. Let's continue to run it a couple more times, and you can see that we're getting different colors on each iteration of our script. That's awesome. Let's continue. If you look at our target scene, you'll notice that there are these planes that we're applying the color to. Let's do that next. I'm going to go above this function right here and create a new function, create color plane. All right, I'm fast forwarding through this typing, but I hope that you are following along at home and typing this all out. So again, at the very beginning, we are creating the plane. So it's the same thing as going in the 3D viewport, hitting Shift A and then mesh and then plane, right? That's what we are doing here. And at the bottom in the info panel, we're just getting that. I literally removed everything, all the parameters that you see here. There's nothing getting passed in. Just getting the active objects again with that helper function defined above, scaling it on the Y, right? And just creating a new material creating a new, setting that name, and using, very important, we're using the hex color code so we can kind of reference what color this was. And then we're setting the diffuse color. And here we have a special, again, helper function. I have a whole video dedicated to this particular function. Go check that out if you're interested, how we're transforming the hex color code into something that Blender can understand. We're just passing in that text string. So we have the hash character and then the hex color code, right? We're basically just passing in a string, a piece of text into this and getting something that Blender can apply in the material. And then we're just getting the currently active object and then appending to the list of the materials, right? Our material that we just created. And then finally returning this plane from this function. Okay, let's copy this and run it in our for loop. Okay, so I'm doing the same exact thing. So we're just calling our new function and then moving the object that we just returned and moving it on the Y, the same thing as we did with the text, and then just adding a bit to the current Y so we can kind of move it along. Let's run that script. All right, we have already something interesting. Let's get the material preview. So I'm gonna hit Z on while hovering over the 3D viewport and then hit material preview and look at that. We can just run this a couple more times and look at that. That's already coming together. At this point, you can say, oh yeah, you know, I'm done with this, but hold on. We have a nice improvement to this code just in a second. Okay, if you notice, you can hover over one of the objects and then select it and then hit G on the keyboards for moving, right? When you start moving the plane, the text doesn't move with that. So we can solve this by parenting the plane and the text to an empty so you can move text and the plane together. So let's see how that's done in Python. I'm gonna go right here and add the code. All right, we are using another helper function that just creates an empty. So again, similar thing, we're just doing this and then selecting, so that's Shift A and then empty and then plane access. So really this function just wraps that in a nice way in one line, setting the name, and then we are parenting. So we're setting the parent of the text object and the plane object to the empty that we just created right here. And then we're just moving that empty. So we don't need this anymore. So we don't need to set the location for those two objects. Let's check out how that looks. Let's run it. All right, looks like it didn't change, but it did. So now you can see the last thing that's selected here, the last active object is the empty. I'm gonna press G and look at that. Our text and our plane is moving together. This is what we wanted to do. But there's one more thing that I'm gonna do. And you wanna guess what? And if you guessed that I'm gonna make a function, you guessed right, that's what I'm gonna do. I'm just gonna create a new function. Just gonna copy this code right here, go up here. So it's pretty straightforward. I just create a new name, passing in, not forgetting to pass in the objects for the text and the plane, then using the hex color code name for the empty, right? And then parenting them and just returning that back to whatever called it. So let's do that right here. All right, let's make sure that everything still works. Run the script and look at that. It still is working. This is great. And if you enjoyed this tutorial and learned something, make sure to give a like to this video. For more videos like this, make sure to subscribe. I'm actually gonna do another video on this topic. I'm gonna use a remade scene. So we're gonna have a scene that's already generated or created by hand, and we're gonna be applying palettes to that scene. So make sure to subscribe for that. And as always, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.